My name is Nayomi Munaweera. So this book is about the civil war in Sri Lanka, which went on from 83 to 2009. A long, long, bloody, brutal, awful war between two enemies that are very intimate, because in Sri Lanka, which you guys all know is a small island off the coast of India, right? I did not have to say that. Say it again.
Where Ravana lived, yes.
Yes, where Ravana lived, yes, exactly. What do I have to tell you? This war went on from 83 till 2009. The death toll was 80 to 100,000. You probably did not hear a lot about it in America, just because it was very far away, and we don't care about the rest of the world, right? We didn't have oil, we didn't have that kind of stuff, so of course Americans didn't care too much. So my background is I'm from Sri Lanka. I'm part of the majority race. So it was a war of two ethnicities. But I didn't grow up in Sri Lanka. I grew up in Nigeria and then Los Angeles. But I spent quite a lot of time in my childhood going back to Sri Lanka for like a month every year. So I had a sense of what was happening, but I didn't experience a lot of it. So what we're gonna do is I'm gonna read, then Kirstin's gonna read, and then we're gonna have a little chat, just talking about the writing process and what it's like and our novels and et cetera, et cetera. So I'm gonna read various different places. I'm gonna start in the very beginning of the book, and this is right at the end of colonization. So I'm referring to the British that are leaving, because the British, of course, colonized all of the world. They were in Sri Lanka till 48. So this is right at that moment. And it kind of sets up the two sides of the Civil War. Okay. Behind the retreating Englishmen, on the new nation's flag is poised a stylized lion, all curving flank and ornate muscle, a long cruel sword gripped in its front paw. It is the ancient symbol of the Sinhala, who believe they are descended from the lovemaking between an exiled Indian princess and a large jungle cat. A green stripe represents that small and much tossed Muslim population. An orange stripe represents a larger Tamil minority. But in the decades that are coming, race riots and discrimination will render the orange stripe inadequate. It will be replaced by a new flag, on its face a snarling tiger, all bared fang and bristling whisker. If the idea of militancy is not conveyed strongly enough, dagger-clawed paws burst forth while cross rifles rear over the cat's head. A rifle-toting tiger, a sword-gripping lion, this is a war that will be waged between related beasts. So I'm gonna skip quite a bit to the middle of the book, and this is a longer section. And it is about race riots that happened in 1983 that really started off this ethnic conflict. So we're taught with the it's in the character of the main character's aunt, and she's telling the story of being in the middle of the riots and what it looked like. So in 83, there were anti-Tamil riots in Colombo, which is the capital of Sri Lanka, and 3,000 people died. So this is the story of that incident. If we could have followed the dead telephone lines that day, followed them across the burning city, down to our aunt's quiet bungalow, and into her bedroom, this is what we would have seen. As smoke rises over Gaul Road, as muffled screams make their way over our gate, and though there are still 2 months to go, our pregnant Aunt Mala's belly is wrenching and twisting. It is the third day of 24-hour curfew, and Anuradha, white-faced, fingernails bitten past their quick, has been watching his wife writhe for the past 2 days. He says, "The hospital, we have to go." And Mala gasps, "No, Anu, please, it's only the heat and the baby kicking." He says, "All right, I'll go and bring the doctor here." But she cannot allow this, has terrible visions of what could happen to him out there in the unseen nightmare beyond their gate. He carries her to their old yellow Volkswagen, the tight, battered bada slippers dangling off her feet. She worries about this, the impropriety of leaving the house in her house slippers. But then Poonam has pulled open the gate and it is too late to ask for other, more appropriate shoes. They drive into the lane. A lull in the faraway shouting, the street festooned in sunlight and birdsong, foliage spilling everywhere, and for a moment there is normalcy, the sense that they are leaving the house for a walk along Galway's Green or Mount Lavinia Beach. They turn onto Gall Road, drive through thick, rolling smoke, glimpse armed men, abandoned cars, looted shops. Mala, the aching of her womb momentarily shocked still, presses a knuckle hand against her mouth. Anuradha whispers, God, as the clearing smoke allows them to see. He is wrenching the wheel around homeward when the hand smacks, splay-fingered against the glass next to Mala's head. A teenage boy in a torn, stained school uniform. Behind him, the mob congeals and the boy in his terror scrambles onto the hood of their car. Through the garnet smears on the windscreen, they see the glint of knives, broken bottles, machetes. The mob surrounds them completely now, and though she cannot see the men's eyes, Mala knows that they are expecting sacrifice. Knows that this Tamil boy in his school uniform, his face squashed against the glass so close to her own, the open fish mouth, the wide eyes, and that terrible gushing cut on his head has been chosen as sacrifice for years of deprivation, broken governmental promises, failed examinations, and decades of relentless physical labor. And the boy himself, knowing this, his hands raised to protect his delicate face, does not even beg for mercy. She hears the door slam. She sees Anuradha push through the men, pull himself onto the car, his body in front of the boys. She hears his words through her own shuddering sobs. This child, he has done nothing. He is no problem for you. Her fingers struggle on the lock. She will jump out. They won't hurt a pregnant woman. There are greater human laws they will abide by. She's sure of it. Just outside her window, through the dirty glass, a machete is raised and hefted from hand to hand. She sees the silver gleam of it, sinks low in her seat. Anuradha negotiating. I can give you money, anything. Just let me take this boy and go. And the voices. What do you have to do with this Tamil Bansa? Ruining the country, think they can take over. Time to teach a lesson they won't forget. Crack some heads before they murder us in our beds. Move aside. Anuradha turns, wraps his arms around the cowering boy. His eyes search for hers through the blood-mirrored glass. She sees the blade raised and brought down, the flutter of his lids so familiar, his body jerking and sagging as it has innumerable times over hers in the sanctity of their bed. But this time, it is the unnamed boy who receives his weight, who shrieks the ear-shattering screams of an animal in terror, more blood than she can imagine, running onto the bright yellow paint of their car. Then 100 hands reaching out and pulling him and the screaming boy into their midst. She's huddled on the floor of the car, arms wrapped around her belly when the door is eased open. A voice in Sinhala whispers, come, Nona, come with me. She looks and sees Alvis, the coconut plucker, slum denizen. Nona, let us go home now. His calloused hands pull her onto the seat and then out of the car. The mob is gathered in front of the car, a blur of limbs and the metallic arc of weapons, but Alvis's sinewy coconut tree clasping arms will not let her break free, throw herself in the midst of the mob, beg for her lover's life. She is hurried away. When the smoke has cleared for a moment, she struggles loose, looks back to see the men on the upturned car like flies on a day-old catch, white cans upturned, gushing gasoline. A roar as a spark ignites, catches, bursts into flame. The men's voices roaring and falling in time to the jumping flames, a dancing circle of men, those on the periphery pushing forward, curious to see what the center holds. A louder shriek as a sarong catches a flying cinder and the circle scatters open. And what is it that my dark aunt sees at this moment? Too grotesque to be revealed, surely, too horrific to be imagined, but in the name of veracity, it too must be told. Two vaguely human figures lurching in an almost comic fashion, garlanded each with a flaming tire. Hands bound, black rubber melting onto skin, red flames dancing skyward, funnels of smoke obscuring wide open mouths, the glimpse of damaged eye. The swirl of men closes ranks, the scene is shut off from Mala's eyes, like a book of naughty illustrations slammed shut. So fast she can almost not accept what she has seen. A soft rain of ash is falling, settling into her hair and skin, at her ear, a steady stream of words. She knows she must concentrate on this to avoid losing herself. She knows she must walk home now without a loving what is sheltering within her to pour out like water onto this smoky street. All right. Sorry to depress the hell out of you guys. Thank you. So that family then, because of the riots, moves to Los Angeles, as you do after riots. and so they are new immigrants, and they're going through the process of becoming Americans, right? Like, which is a thing you do. All right, so there's four in the family. They're in LA, they're in an apartment, blah, blah, blah. Okay. Amma has never really cooked before. It wasn't necessary, she says. Alice was always there, but now there is a necessity of feeding us, and so the recipes come. Transcribed on onion skin, thin blue aerograms, Alice's words transcribed through Sylvia Sinatra's hand to our mother's ear. She reads them frowning, her mind fixed on the intricacies of substitution. What can she use in place of gotukola, jaggery, coconut oil? The myriad things that do not grow in this foreign soil. She must learn the skill of appropriation. To use spinach when the recipe calls for gotukola, brown sugar for jaggery, olive oil for coconut oil. On weekends, she takes us in search of potent spices and fresh vegetables. We brave Mexican markets where quivering brains, coiled intestines, and the enormous scarlet hearts of bulls lie in piles while we look for red chili and turmeric. We buy exotic vegetables we've only seen in shiny foreign cookbooks. Broccoli, hard and cool white cauliflower. We bear these treasures home, heavy brown bags in our laps in the lurching bus, ignoring the curious sideway glances of other passengers. In the apartment, Amma roasts curry powder in the oven. Lanka and I crush mustard and cumin seed with a mortar and pestle. Vegetables pile on the counters, carrots and beetroot greens trailing off the edge like the blue-green plumage of tropical birds. Pots boil, spices fry, oil sizzles. The room is shrouded in steam, which wafts into the hallways and makes our neighbors, those erstwhile Mexicans and dutiful Chinese, glance up curiously, inhale sharply and deeply. But they are only curious. They have their own foodie witchcraft to remind them of various homelands. It is only the envy-eyed landlady who wrinkles her nose as she walks by our open window. She drags her equally overweight Dachshund on the end of a leash and gossips about us to the dog. Oh, are they making your nose twitch, my wiggums? These Indians always cooking with their onions and their curry. How can they breathe in there? Must be used to it. Where they come from must be like a palace. Inside, Lanka and I stifle giggles. She thinks we're Indians? We've never even been to India. Amma pushes a sweaty hand against her forehead and frowns. This landlady is the bane of her life, coming often to complain about the smells coming out of our windows or the noise we supposedly make. Amma is always sweet and courteous on these occasions, but now inside the sanctity of her own crowded and tiny kitchen, she whispers, "Ooh, my little boogums, why don't you just come over here and kiss your mommy on the mouth with your dirty little dog breath and your filthy little dog teeth? Come here, little boogums." She pantomimes a fat woman swaying elephantine walk, the way she holds a poor squirming dog high in the air, bringing it down to her lipstick mouth to kiss passionately. Tata, too, has come into the kitchen now. The three of us hold our hands tight against our mouths to hold in the giggles, but it is no use. And outside, the landlady stands nonplussed, listening to the gales of laughter floating out of our window into the sunshine. Okay. A little bit more in that section. In these first years, we learn the lesson of our inadequacies. In school, we learn quickly that the smell of our bodies is shameful and must be dissipated by perfume or deodorant, that the hair on our legs, that fine down that we had never noticed before, must be daily shaved to smoothness, that certain kinds of clothes are acceptable, and these do not include the ones we have brought with us from the old country, are those that Amma makes for us, no matter how painstakingly on her old beaten singer. We learn that acceptable clothes can only come from stores, and for this reason, we become shoppers at the local bargain basements, the Salvation Armies and the Goodwills, looking for sweaters, jeans, shirts that will mark us as normal, as acceptable and undistinguished in the crowd. We learn also that hair conditioner comes in bottles and must be bought separately from cooking oil. We learn that although we have been speaking English from birth, people cannot tell understand the crispness of the Queen's English mixed effortlessly with the roundness of Sinhala in our mouths. We have sing-song accents, they say, a tendency to substitute V's when W's are called for and vice versa, so that V-E-I-L comes out sounding like a large sea mammal. I'm not gonna say it. Whale. Various conversations are thus rendered incoherent. These are lessons about shame learned by watching eyes, by noticing the way the other kids wrinkle their noses or pretend not to see us when we sit next to them at the lunch table or on the school bus. By careful observation, we realize that adaptation and emulation will be necessary if we are to survive in this new place. So quite quickly, we learn to shed our old clothes, our old manners. We say cookie now, quite effortlessly, knowing that the word biscuit will be answered with blankness. Familiar to anyone? Okay, another short migration part, and then one more, just two more short ones. Okay, same character, same part. At Christmas, we gather at Uncle Ananda's. Every year, there are more families looking lost and speaking in thick accents. The women have forests of hair on their legs and armpits. They wear cheap skirts to the ankle and unflattering haircuts. Their husbands wear tight suits and rubber sandals. Their children are clad in either frothy pink or light blue, according to the appropriate gender. They waft a certain specifically island odor, a suggestion of sweat, coconut oil, and turmeric. Every year they come looking more and more shell-shocked. It is impossible to tell what they have seen, what they are escaping. They do not ever talk about these things. They seem so foreign to us. They have not yet learned to suppress their smells and moderate their voices. They are surprised by too much and too easily impressed by America. In a few years, these children will be wearing jeans. Their mothers will be perfectly coiffed, and their fathers will smell of cologne. But for now, we keep our distance, lest the aura of foreignness so laboriously shed rubs off on us. All right, one more short thing. And this is what I think of as my eulogy to everybody that died in the war. So it's sort of like my, you know, acknowledging. And it's at the very end. I dream of the 80,000 who did not live into this moment, those who were left behind in the lagoons and paddy fields, in the cement jail cells, in the white vans, beneath the rolling waves of the ocean, those who were broken, dismantled, disappeared, those who were shattered in bomb blasts, those who were bludgeoned, burned in tires, thrown from helicopters into the sea, those who were taken in the midst of giving speeches, those who were taken from their beds in the night, those who were lampposted, those who were pitched into the rivers, those who were taken as children, those who were pierced by shrapnel, those who lost limbs to the landmines, those who lost eyes, hearts, livers, the tender, pulsing, precious flesh, those who were called to strap bombs on and detonate themselves. I dream of the one that I can give a name to, and that other, her unnamed, unloved assassin. 80,000, it is a number beyond comprehension. I must mourn for them. I must cry and shake and tremble for them. I shall cry for a long time. And then, When my weeping is spent, when I have no more sorrow to give, I shall celebrate peace. I shall wake up from these long decades of war and begin to see what we can do in peace, what sort of creatures we are when the mask of lion or tiger falls from us. Yep.
All right. Yeah. I could listen to you read forever. Oh. You have such a soothing voice. I'm just going to read two short sections from my book, Soy Sauce for Beginners, and then Nayomi and I will ask each other a few general writing questions, and hopefully you guys will have some questions too. Soy Sauce for Beginners. These are some of my favorite smells: toasting bagel, freshly cut figs, the bergamot in good Earl Grey tea, a jar of whole soybeans slowly turning beneath a tropical sun. You'd expect the latter to smell salty, meaty, flaccid, like what you'd smell if you unscrewed the red cap of the bottle on a table in your neighborhood Chinese restaurant and stuck your nose in as far as it would go. But real fermenting soybeans smell nothing like sauce in a plastic bottle. Tangy and pungent like rising bread or wet earth, these soybeans smell of history, of life, of tiny patient movements unseen by the naked eye. Everything I know about soy sauce, I learned from my father and my uncle and my late grandfather. We are a family who can talk endlessly about soybeans and all of their intricacies. But that morning at the family soy sauce factory, I was in no mood to chat. The only thing on my mind was the 90-degree heat. Heat rose from the ground through my thin-soled flats. It filled my nostrils, mouth, and ears. Sweat bloomed under my arms, in the creases of my elbows, in the pockets behind my knees. Even in the shade beneath the factory's red-striped awning, the air felt thick enough to drink. Flanked by my father and my uncle, I shifted my weight from one swollen foot to another and wished the clients would hurry up and get here. In the last 3 months, I'd turned 30, gotten separated from my husband, and prepared to take a hiatus from San Francisco, my home of 15 years. Now it was August. I'd been back in Singapore and living in my parents' house for the past week. At my father's urging, I'd agreed to temp at the factory, taking on mundane administrative tasks that had little to do with soy sauce. Even though I'd held this new job for exactly 4 days, my inexperience hadn't stopped my father from insisting I attend this meeting. Forming a visor with the flat of my hand, I squinted at the logo embedded in the center of the compound gate, thick brushstrokes that formed Lin, the Chinese character for my family name. Since the founding of Lin Soy Sauce by my grandfather 50 years earlier, the factory had grown into a gated campus with three squat concrete buildings surrounding a central courtyard. The architecture was spare and utilitarian, almost ascetic, as though any kind of ornamentation would distract from the task of creating soy sauce. My father, my uncle, and I were standing on the steps of the building that housed the office staff. And each time the glass door swung open, a wave of air conditioning rushed out, providing temporary relief from the heat. If my father noticed my discomfort, he chose to ignore it. He checked his old-fashioned flip phone for missed calls. He removed his glasses and began to polish them on the edge of his shirt. Stripped of their familiar shield, Ba's eyes looked puffy and helpless. When he caught me watching, he smiled. Tiny lines radiated outward from his temples, as if etched into his skin with a fine-toothed comb. It was a simple smile, involuntary, the kind of smile you flashed at a toddler wearing a funny hat. And in spite of myself, I smiled back. On my other side, my uncle pulled an already limp handkerchief from his pocket and swiped it across the back of his neck. Where Ba was wiry and compact, Uncle Robert was tall and wide by Singaporean standards, with an ample belly perched precariously atop his belt. He grinned at me. "Hot, right?" he asked cheerfully. He reached over and squeezed my father's bicep. "Gretchen is American now," he said, elongating the word and chuckling. "Can no longer tahan the heat." Singaporeans take perverse pride in the local climate, where temperatures rise to the high 80s year-round and never dip below 75 degrees. Our tiny island sits off the southernmost tip of the Malaysian Peninsula in Southeast Asia, just 1 degree shy of the equator. In polite conversation, we'll tell you we have two seasons, hot and wet, and hot and dry. In less polite conversation, we'll reveal there are three, hot, very hot, and very fun. During my time in the Bay Area, I learned to keep my mouth shut when my American friends complained of the humidity. Standing there on the front steps with my silk blouse pasted to my back, I thought of crisp San Francisco fall days of warm sunlight on cold skin. I'm gonna jump ahead to a short section that takes place, or rather Gretchen is remembering an incident that takes place when she's a very young child in Singapore. The American visiting professor was named Colin Clark. He had come from the University of Chicago to give a seminar at my mother's university. To welcome him and his wife, the humanities chair hosted a dinner at a seafood restaurant on the eastern coast of the island that was famous for its chili crab. At first, my father tried to get out of attending the dinner. It was no secret that he found Ma's colleagues exhausting. They sat around discussing books he hadn't read, and when he tried to bring up something he'd seen in the paper or on TV, they humored him for a minute or two before taking up the previous topic of conversation. But Ma insisted she could not show up alone. All the other spouses would be there. Eventually, Pa relented, but on the night of the dinner, he announced that I was coming too. Ma was not pleased. I had just turned 10, and my opinion of these gatherings fell in line with my father's. If it hadn't been for the chili crab, I would have refused to attend. In between lectures by various faculty members on the history of Singapore cuisine for the benefit of the foreign visitors, Ma and her colleagues discussed their research and their classes. Ba and the other spouses quickly ran out of ways to participate in the conversation and spent the rest of the dinner nodding and smiling politely. Every once in a while, a grown-up asked me what my favorite subject was in school or whether I was enjoying the food. But other than that, I was left alone. Colin Clark's face has faded from my memory, but I can still picture his wife, a frightfully thin woman with poofy hair the color of pomegranates, who complained about the humidity and the spiciness of the food. She finally agreed to taste a single morsel of crab, then pointedly wiped off her sauce-stained fingers on a disposable towelette. Only one other aspect of that dinner stuck with me. Near the end of the meal, I noticed Ma and Colin Clark discussing some writer or philosopher they both admired. Something about the tilt of their shoulders or the angles of their heads caught my attention, and when I glanced back a while later, it was clear from the way they neglected their bowls of honeydew sago that their conversation was far from over. Before I could ponder the heaviness that settled in my limbs, Ba threw back the last of his beer and cleared his throat. He leaned over, looped an arm over Ma's shoulder, and questioned them in a loud, strident voice about this philosopher of theirs. What startled me was neither his aggressive manner nor the questions themselves, but the way he spoke. By peppering his speech with phrases like, "no kidding," and "sure thing," and "you don't say," my father was mimicking an American accent. His eyes glittered feverishly, his face and neck burned bright red. Another colleague tried to engage him in a different discussion, but he would not turn his attention from Ma and the American. After that, someone, probably the humanities chair, signaled for the check. The academics and their spouses reached for their purses and rose from the table. In the parking lot, Ma walked briskly to the car, ignoring Ba's comments about the evening. All the way home, Ba continued to speak in that strange voice, and when Ma told him to drop it, he widened his eyes and said he had no idea what she was talking about. One evening, about a month after Colin Clark's arrival, Ba didn't come home for dinner. The following evening, it happened again. Hours later, when he finally returned, Ma hurried down the stairs, the door to the study swung shut, and the arguing started. I lay awake in bed listening. I was old enough to know something was seriously wrong. At first, my parents' voices were too soft for me to hear, but then I heard the American's name spoken by Ba in that hideous accent, and my mother's voice rose in a shriek. Images from that night came back to me, the way Ma had laughed wildly at Colin Clark's jokes, how at the end of the night, his wife had refrained from taking Ma's hand, instead raising her palm in a half-hearted wave. My parents' voice grew steadily louder, and when I could listen no longer, I got out of bed and ran the faucet in the tub at full blast. There in the warm bath I lay, watching my fingers and toes shrivel as if from old age. My parents' argument stretched through the week. On day 4, Ba peeked into my room after midnight, walked through the half-open door of the ensuite bathroom, and found me asleep in a tub of tepid water. He wrapped me in a large fluffy towel and carried me to bed. The next morning, the two of us drove to Uncle Robert's house, where I was to stay while he and Ma took care of, quote, grown-up business. I didn't point out I was too old to be spoken to like that. The drive over was the first time we'd been alone together in days, and I was both furious at him and comforted by his presence. Unable to put my conflicting emotions into words, I simply asked, "When can I come home?" "Soon," my father said. "In a few days, your ma or I will come get you." Divorce was still rare in Singapore, but I worried all the same. What would it take to drive my mother back to her beloved America? In front of my uncle's house, Ba stretched his lips into a tired smile, and I tried to smile back. As much as I longed to ask questions, I sensed this wasn't the time and that he might not even have the answers.
Nayomi, I'm interested in your thoughts about how a writer handles violence as a topic in a responsible way, particularly when you're writing about a situation where there's so much violence. Mm-hmm. And in the reality, like, it's not gratuitous at all. Like, it is omnipresent and horrible. And yet, when you handle it in fiction, do you think it risks becoming gratuitous? And if so, what do you do to avoid that?
Mm-hmm. That's such a good question. And I had to think about that a great deal because I was taking on this subject that was the civil war in Sri Lanka, this huge death toll and all of that. And I think that the most effective way you do this is through completely entering the character. So if you inhabit the character well enough, you are telling the story through their eyes. And you're, I mean, the way I write is I sort of take on the skin of that character. So this, you know, my book, the scene I read with the riots, that's one of my very violent scenes. And then I have a few more. It's not a completely violent book. There's just like 3 scenes maybe that are really painful. There's actually another scene that is harder, and it's an act of sexual violence against this woman in the north of the country, which clearly you guys know what I'm talking about. That was incredibly difficult to write because I had to take on her personality, figure out what that would feel like. So I think the way that you do it is you really get that character down. Because if you're telling it from the outside, it can become gratuitous. It can become like overly sensationalized. But if you're doing it from the point of view of a person, so it's much more grounded, right? Like in that scene, it's third person, but you are feeling what she's feeling. Like you are the pregnant woman watching the husband getting killed in this horrific way. So it's very, very personal. It's not, the lens is like not out. And you know, also, I mean, the thing about it is I didn't grow up in Sri Lanka. Like I grew up in Nigeria and America, and we would go back home, whatever home is, for a month every year. So I didn't see the worst of the violence, but I did have a few experiences. Like I'll tell you guys really quickly. We were once in the 80s, we went to a flower show because my aunt, like a character in the book, grows orchids. And we were at this flower show and we were setting up her booth, putting the flowers out. And then my cousin was like, "Let's go for ice cream." Of course, never say no to ice cream. It'll save your life. We go out, like 5 cousins, we go out, we're getting the ice cream, and then there's like this giant noise, like a truck has slammed into a wall, and there's an explosion. So there was a bomb in the flower show. And, you know, there's chaos, and then they start bringing out wounded people, like nobody died, but like wounded people on stretchers, people are bleeding, all this is happening. And I felt what that would feel like, the absolute terror of that moment. and not knowing what had happened. And then they sort of cleared up, and then we went back in, and on the wall right by my aunt's booth, there was shrapnel. There's like ball bearings and stuff, because these are dirty bombs. So they're supposed to explode and put stuff in you that then rots, you know, turns gangrene, whatever, bad. So, you know, literally, that could have been us, minutes. And then the other side of that is then we went to dinner that night, and we were joking about it. Not us. The Americans were like, oh, fuck, what happened? Like, what just happened? The Sri Lankans were joking, like, ah, oh, you were so scared. Haha, you know? Like,
yeah.
Yeah. Because they live with this. This is normal. This is like every day. And not every day does a bomb go off, but you get on a bus, you don't know. You know, my cousin who lived through it said of his family of four, they would never all four get on the same bus. They would divide up, which is heartbreaking, right? So there's that. The other side of that story that I didn't know till very recently, my dad told me that in that bomb explosion, there was a Tamil woman, and she thought that they would finger her as the bomber. So he just said he saw this look of terror on her face, and she was just running. So that, because I'm Sinhala, we're Sinhala, so that's the other side. Like, we were afraid, but she was afraid of getting taken to jail and tortured or whatever because they thought she had something to do with it. So again, like, what do you do with violence? You try to enter it as just get in there and tell it from a specific point of view, which is not the outsider. And I'm saying that even though the most violent parts of my book take place in a region of the country I've never been to a person whose ethnicity is not mine. But I think as a writer, you can enter. You use your imagination, you use research, you do whatever you have to do to enter. Yeah? Okay. Yeah. Sorry that took so extremely long.
No, that's so interesting. Foodie witchcraft, that was from your book.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Oh, my God. I have so much food in my book, which you probably do too, right?
Yeah, well, I mean, it's interesting because I think it's something that readers really look for. And yes. I know we're going to talk about this a little bit in our, we have a panel that we're doing later on how much you sell your culture in the stories. And so it's interesting, the street names and the food details, was that something that you knew you wanted to have in your book? Was that sort of a touchstone, like you wanted people to be able to visualize the street and the places where people live, or were you sort of okay with imagining?
Great question. You know, I did in that scene, there were like specific roads and stuff. Because I, you know, when you're writing, you're like, who is the audience? I don't know who the audience is. I know Sri Lankans are going to read that and be like, oh yeah, Gaul Road, of course, it's our big road, blah, blah, blah. Americans are going to be like, I don't know what that is. But it sort of sets you in the place more. You get that this is a real place. The food, I was like, okay, I'm writing about these terrible things. I have to balance it with something that is just beautiful and evocative and like happy and, you know, food. That was what food was for me. I just finished a second novel that's coming out next year, and again, really hard stuff. Not war, but dark stuff. And I balanced it with flowers, so there's tons of flower images. But for you, like, did you plan to use the food?
Yeah, you know, I mean, the thing is, like, Singapore is kind of a nation obsessed with food. I don't know if Sri Lanka is the same way, but in Singapore, we have no sports teams, and we have very little politics, and so food is kind of the thing that people talk about. And so it kind of was very natural, but I was surprised by how much readers sort of gravitated toward, and even my agent and my editor, they were kind of like, this book is about food.
Yeah.
And it was something that I hadn't really thought about, because in Singapore, that's just part of...
It's just normal.
It's just everything we talk about. In fact, my editor wanted to put recipes in the book that I was like, no, yeah, no, but yeah, but her first I was like, what if we had? And I was like, no, I don't think that's the right tone, but I appreciate that you like the food aspect of it.
One other quick question.
Oh, yeah.
Regarding novels, you're writing another one, you have now two then?
It's coming out in spring.
I have a question, is your first novel like this baby that you just love and savor? I'm just curious, because
well, my first novel took me 6 years to write and see into publication. So for that reason alone, you know, with every passing year that you wait for it to come out, the stakes just grow higher and higher. And then you start to, what if I wasted 6 years of my life? And your mind goes there. So I think for that reason, the sort of emotional weight of the first novel is very large. And yeah, so yeah, it does feel that way. But I mean, I kind of feel that way about my second novel now. Mm-hmm. So I don't know that it's going to be much different. Maybe because you've already sold your second, you have.
Yeah, I mean, they're all babies. You know, they're all just like parts of your heart. I don't have children, but this is like, I don't know if there are any mothers in here that are like, shut up, that's stupid. but I don't have them. So this is the closest I can imagine to having something of yours that you've birthed and created and is out. And again, the long publication process. I started writing that book in 2001.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. and then it came out initially in Sri Lanka in a very small, you've heard this all before, in a very small printing of 1,000 books in 2012. Wow. So that's how long it took.
Were you writing the whole time? Or were you?
No, I wrote this book and tried to publish it in 2009, and the American publishers were not interested.
Oh, and then you
so
went
then
back.
I
okay.
wrote a middle
so still
book.
7 years though that you wrote
yeah.
it.
Yeah, I wrote a different book that won't see print for a while, and then a friend of mine was like, "Try in Sri Lanka," which I was very scared about because I didn't grow up there, you know. So there's a like, I'm gonna tell them their story.
Mm-hmm,
like,
mm-hmm.
That's really scary. It came out in Sri Lanka. Really did really well. A few death threats, but that's okay. when you're talking about political race stuff,
yeah.
Of course, that's a thing. Came out in India, and in India, it was up for every major prize. So that was like the turning point. It was up for the prize. It's called the DSC Prize for South Asian Literature. I was on the short list of six. If I won, I would have been the only woman to win at that point.
Wow.
I didn't win. Jhumpa Lahiri won it the next year. So
now I have to be the second woman.
I know, right? I'm like, really? Yeah. Like, she needs it? She's like, oh, I'll just put this on my whatever. like, she needs $50,000. But then, because of that, America was like, oh, hey, you, we remember
wow.
you.
Wow, so this, because this book came out 2014.
In America.
Wow.
It was out in 2012.
That's interesting.
Interesting, right?
Yeah.
Like, so the backwards route.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, the question, I mean, I love both of them. I mean, the second one was easier to write because I kind of knew what I was doing. I was more confident about it. But they're all babies,
mm-hmm.
right?
Yeah,
yeah,
I think so.
Yeah.
The question, so this is kind of to both of you. As writers and women of color, do you feel pressured to tell a certain story, like you have to tell the immigrant story, or no, you have to tell like the woman's bildungsroman from it, where she needs to, once she gets divorced, and has to go through all these things?
It's a great question.
Do you
want to
take it?
Yeah, sure. I mean, yeah, no, it's a great question. I think that, for this book, I don't feel like I felt pressured to write the story. This was the story I wanted to write. However, when my agent went to sell the story, I realized what the market wanted.
Mm-hmm.
And then I kind of felt like lucky that I was writing the story that the market wanted. Because what happens when your next book isn't a bildungsroman, or your next book isn't set in a place? You know, so this book is set in Singapore, and there hasn't been that much writing from Singapore. And that was something people really were excited about. And then there was a big Singapore book right before mine came out, which was called Crazy Rich Asians by Kevin Kwan.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, and so like it was sort of like the timing was good. And so at first, I felt really lucky about that. And then I thought like, okay, but if my next book is set in Singapore, is it going to be saturated?
Mm.
And if my next book is actually set in China, there's a ton of books about China.
Mm.
And so it just made me think, you know, It's great when your story lines up with the market forces, but it really makes you think about what's gonna, I mean, you don't want that to dictate the choices that you're making as a writer.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's almost like you have to block it out a little bit, otherwise you just wouldn't get any work done.
Yeah, yeah.
Mm-hmm. And I do think that to some extent that it's very apparent as a writer of color, but I think all writers to some extent deal with that.
I mean, I think that people think they know what the market wants, but nobody knows.
Right.
You know, I think people are like, they want this, they want this. My first book, because a lot of it is set in Sri Lanka, people are like, oh, maybe Americans won't be interested. My second book is set mostly in America, and so my agent is like, oh, that's going to do better, which is the opposite of what she's saying.
Yeah.
They're like, it's going to do better because it's set in America, and Americans are more interested in America. So, like, nobody knows anything
at
the end of the day. You know, like, there are definitely market trends, like if you're a South Asian writer, they want you to write about arranged marriage, which I feel like, oh my God, it's been done so many times. And I think there are great ways to do it that are new, but they haven't been done for a while.
Mm-hmm.
But I think there are ways that you can completely redo that. But you can't really write to the market. You just it's not going to be good. For me, I don't know, maybe other people can.
Yeah, and I feel like I don't have that much control over my ideas. Yes. You know, like to have an idea that sustains a novel, like I've only had two in my life. How do I, you know, like if I were trying to work with the market,
absolutely,
I would have none maybe.
Yeah, so. I agree. I mean, it's like, it's a really mysterious process.
Yeah.
I don't know what I'm doing. It's a mysterious thing that we do. We sit down and we like make up worlds and this stuff comes out and you're like, what, who is this? I don't know, well, who was I? I'll write all day and then I'll stop and I'll walk out and I'm in a daze, like I'm in like this strange fog and I don't know what I did. I like time is going and I'm like, I mean, it's hard work, you know this if you're right. It's very hard work emotionally, like hard work. But like the time goes by and then the pages are like there. I'm like, I don't know who did that. So that makes me sound completely crazy. Okay, good. It's a very mysterious thing. So like how to align that with the market, I wouldn't know.
Yeah.
I mean, maybe Stephen King does. No, he doesn't.
But
he
I think genre writing is, he's already Stephen King.
He's Stephen King, right?
I do think that genre writers maybe have a different approach. Like they're very clear about,
right,
you know,
like romance writers, right? They have.
Or mystery writers.
Mystery writers, right? Like I went to, what is this? Authors on the Move here, which is an amazing event.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh yeah, great. So I was at a table, like you go to different tables. There's a table of all mystery writers. And they were like, what's your third book? I'm like, I don't know. They're like, you should be a mystery writer because we have the
formula.
They
all had like 17 books. Like,
yeah,
they're like, I'm on my 36th book.
Yeah, and all of them. Like there was like, I don't know, 15 women and they had all written books. They're like, you should be a mystery writer or a romance writer. They give you the formula and then you like plug it in and it's apparently lucrative.
That's another question I have. If you get a contract and then you're supposed to write so many books by such and such a time, I would think that that would stop me up because I'd be in fear all the time. I'm not going to get it, you know, it's not going to come out. So I'm thinking that that would stop the process.
I've never had to write a book on contract, have you?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, there you go.
So this book is one of a two-book deal.
Oh,
so the second one is already coming, is also with St. Martin's. I was really lucky because I had this time in which the book had not come out in America, but had come out in Asia. So I did like my book tour in Asia and like did all that kind of stuff. And then I came here and nobody knew anything about me or my book. So I could really work on book two. And then the first book only came out in America in September. And which I, at that point I was in editing for the second book.
Oh, that's great.
Which was really nice. So I'm extremely lucky that way. So I didn't, then I started doing publicity and finishing the second book, but there wasn't this like, what's your second book? And now, of course, there is. Now there's like pressure, but it's out. Like, I mean, it's out of my hands. It's gone to the whatever printers or whatever. Third book, who knows? You know, like it's like my agent was like, okay, what's the third book? I'm like, no idea yet.
Wait, I was just wondering, you know, you talk about cultures that America doesn't know much about and incidents we don't know much about, and how do you balance the educational piece with telling a story? Because you, obviously it's not nonfiction, it's a fiction, so how do you find that balance?
Yeah, that's a great question. It's something that I've thought about a lot. And I think that, I said this to Nayomi when we were on the phone yesterday. I was like, you know, our job as writers of color isn't to be a tour guide to your culture. Like, that is not good storytelling.
Yeah.
And I always, you know, when I was writing this book and thinking about the thinking about those questions, especially as it got out of my closest circle of readers and went into the hands of my agent and my editor and other people, I thought about, you know, as a child in Singapore, most of the books that I read were set in America and England. So I used to read these, which is just, there are not that many Singaporean writers. It's a very small country. Mm-hmm. And I used to read this series called Enid Blyton.
Did
you?
Oh my God! Of
right,
course.
Everybody from the
Commonwealth. Do you guys know Enid Blyton? No.
Yeah, nobody in America. No, it's like these
America.
Boarding school books. So like the
huge in the rest of the world.
Everybody
huge.
In India, Singapore, like, we were all yeah. British colonies. So that's the reason. But it's this little girl who goes off to boarding school, and I think she goes off at the age of 11, mm-hmm. and she rides trains by herself. The point being, this was a world that I had knew nothing about, mm-hmm. and it was completely foreign. But that was the beauty of it, and it was kind of like, okay, if everybody in England sends their kids to school at 11, I accept that premise and I'll go with it. And I think that was important for me to remember as a writer. You know, part of the reason we live is to read is to be immersed in other cultures.
Yes.
It's okay if readers are confused sometimes. They can look it up. And
yes.
if, you know, some readers don't want to do that, and that's okay. They won't read your particular book.
Right.
But I think it's important to know that, you know, it's okay for the reader to be a little lost sometimes. They're in a foreign place. They should be.
So this is such an interesting point because, like, Enid Blyton has, like, there's hundreds, right?
Yeah.
She had hundreds of children's books, and they were famous all over the world. I was reading them in Nigeria. She was reading them in Singapore.
Yep.
Because these are ex-British colonies. So everyone in the, like, ex-British colonies, like, knows Enid Blyton. I've had this same exact conversation with so many writers, and they were like, the boarding school, and the, like, midnight feast.
Totally.
And the, like, adventures in the forest, and the traveling circus, blah, blah, blah. We all have had the same education. And I was in Nigeria being like, I want a midnight feast. Like, I want to go to boarding school. This is so boring, Nigeria. Like, I wish I was in England. I mean, I want to wear mittens.
But that too, I mean, even something like snow, like if you hadn't seen, there was no snow in Singapore, but you just kind of accept that these things happen. That you know, they don't have to explain snow to me.
Totally, so exotic and so desirable. I wanted to eat kippers really badly. No idea what that was, but I wanted them. What this also means is we're not seeing ourselves on the page.
Yes,
right?
Of course.
Which is a really giant, like, not seeing yourself on the page is like, as a child is, I don't know, like, your experience is not important. This other experience of these other children who are privileged, going to boarding school, blah, 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 that's important. Like, what I'm going through is not important. So it wasn't until I came to America, totally British education, and then I discovered, like, I was in the library and discovered, like, Gabriel Garcia Marquez. Oh my God. Like, South America. Then the Indian writers, right? And then, oh my God, Sri Lanka? Like, is it possible? Mm-hmm. Then I discovered the Sri Lankan writers, and then it's like, this is like coming home because mm-hmm. I'm seeing families like mine on the page. I'm seeing, like, character, like, the experience, like, oh, it's worth writing about. And for writers of color, this is a very normal experience. Like, everyone's gone through this. Everyone starts with the British and American mm-hmm, writers mm-hmm. and then finds their way and then goes, oh, my stories are also important. I didn't know that. Okay. And it's everyone has this, right? Because imagine if you were only reading stories from India and you don't see your American experience. Weird.
But I'm having a question. Are you only put in that box of writers of color now? Or
unfortunately, well, I wish we were just writers.
Because to me, when you started talking on that, I'm going, oh, now I'm getting a little lost because I just consider it writing.
Well, you are wonderful. And we would hope that this becomes more of a normalized thing. But the odds are really stacked against writers of color right now. So we have to bring attention to that. And the way we can do that is to be like, we're writers of color. So I said this in my workshop, is the New York Times summer reading list just came up. 100% white writers. 100%. So we, as writers of color, we have to be like, hey, this is an issue, this is a problem. Because, like, if our books are not on there, not specifically that list, but that's the big list. If we're not on there, people are not reading us, which means they're reading, like, white mainstream, usually male writers, which is it's a problem, you know? So even if we don't want to consider ourselves that, we are put in that category. Because if it was just writers, then a whole bunch of names would have shown up on that list. Mm-hmm.
To go back to the fact that all writers are somehow, well, you know, whether you're a female writer or a mystery writer or a Western writer or a, you know, New York writer, you put into this box. Mm-hmm. So I all the publicity that I've done in America, a lot of the publicity that I do in the U.S. has to do with being an Asian American writer. Mm-hmm. And I did my first interview in Singapore with a Singapore newspaper, and the reporter asked me, "Are you afraid of being typecast?" And I said, "Typecast? What do you mean?" And she said, well, you know, young woman, like, finds herself through food. You're just like Eat, Pray, Love. And I thought to myself, this is the first time I've been compared to a non-Asian writer. Because mm-hmm. in America, my most salient feature is I'm a writer of color. Mm-hmm. And in Singapore, yeah, I'm typecast maybe in a different way. But it was so interesting to be in a country where they didn't see it as a minority character looking for her identity. You know, like, it was just a woman living her mm-hmm. life. Mm-hmm. And you might have a different experience in Sri Lanka.
No, so,
but it's kind of freeing in that way to be able to be in a place where where the race isn't sort of the most salient feature.
That's really interesting because here I'm definitely seen as a female writer of color. This is a thing.
Right.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah,
of course.
Yeah.
In Sri Lanka, they see me as an American writer.
Oh. Yeah.
It's kind of ridiculous. Because I was teaching a workshop at the Colombo University in Sri Lanka, and it's all writing students, English students. So I'm like, these guys must have read my book, because if anyone's reading, it's got to be the English students. And I had like 30 kids, and I'm like, who's read my book? And like 3 people raised their hand. I'm like, are you kidding? Like, really? Like, not even here. Like, I mean, it's doing well, but like here, these kids should all be reading it, because there's not that many Sri Lankan writers writing in English. I'm like, what's going on to the professor? She's like, oh, you are in a thing called diaspora writing.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Wow.
You are in the diaspora. I'm like, oh my God. Great. Wow. So they really, even culturally, when I'm in Sri Lanka, they see me as American.
Yeah.
And clearly in America, also American, you know? So this is the strange place, and clearly that's not quite your experience.
A little bit. I mean, I thought, yeah, a little bit. Mm-hmm. But I think that Singapore, people come and go a lot. Mm, like, it's a country that's extremely cosmopolitan. Yes. Everybody, a lot of people go away for school, and so I think because of that.
Yeah.
But I mean, it's something I think about. Like, I often think about whether I should not read an American accent. Because when I'm in Singapore, I don't speak with an American accent, and then I always, it's kind of like navigating this weird. But then I don't want to be disingenuous because my writing career has taken place mostly in America.
Totally.
And so you do think about like whether you have a right to tell the story, which is something that the readers in your home country are thinking. And so you're right. It's always tricky to navigate. But then I think, you know, even if I were living in Singapore right now, somebody would still have a problem with the story, right? So at some point you have to shut it down and just...
Yeah. I mean, like, I've had someone tell me that if I put on a sari and big ethnic jewelry and go to these kind of things, I'd probably sell more books.
Oh my God. Oh my gosh.
It might be true. I'm not going to do it, but it's very possibly true, right?
On a side note, when Michael and I did the Sacramento Authors on the Move, do you remember there was a Western writer who wrote like Victorian Westerns, and she was dressed in a costume. Yeah, and I thought, you know what? She probably sells a lot of books. So there you go.